I decided that I couldn't leave this earth without telling somebody about my story. I really never intended for anybody, frankly, to read it. It was something I was going to do, put it away, and then perhaps someday take it out of a vault, and maybe someday my grandchildren might read this. But then something else happened. I wrote the book, and I purposely sent it to people that would easily relate to my topic: parents, kids, and abuse. I got a call from one of the mothers that I'd sent the book to. She came back to me and she said, "You know, I think we could have saved 2 or 3 kids of going through what you went through because I read your book." Right then and there, I decided my mission was over. I had accomplished really everything that I intended. If I could have made a difference in 2 or 3 kids' lives, it was great. If I can get parents and even clinicians like psychologists and sociologists, if I can even get people in the care community having a tool that they can provide to others to say, "Hey, read this, this is the way it really was," then I will feel like my job is done.
Birds flying high, you know how I feel. Sun in the sky, you know how I feel. Breeze drifting on by, you know how I feel. It's a new dawn, it's a new day. It's a new life for me, yeah. It's a new dawn, it's a new day. It's a new life for me.
My journey of writing the book started with my own kind of excavation of who I was and how I got there. But it now started to involve a greater purpose, which is I really hope that I can help save some kids. I can give parents an opportunity to think through what parenting is. And maybe, this is a tough one, and maybe get some people to realize that they shouldn't be parents. That is, that not everybody is really great at raising children. That's why I jumped into this river at my age. And given everything that I've done, it's what I wanted to kind of leave as my legacy. This is the most important thing I've ever done in my life. So it's something that I hope others will find important also. I spent 6 years with Disney, and I saw how the animation building a movie process worked. I saw what they went through. I especially saw how, you know, directors and even Walt would look at a film as a series of scenes. And those scenes had to be glued together in a way that created a story. So in my writing, it's the only way I can write. 2 things have animated my writing, speaking of animation, was filmmaking. And the other was music. I have to hear a rhythm. I have to write rhythmically. I have to hear the music in my head. And I have to move from scene to scene, not a linear step-by-step process. That's why I was a terrible academic. I was horrible. I got by, but I was horrible because I could not write research-based kind of prose. I couldn't do it. Just wasn't me. So I wrote stories that passed as research prose. And so that Disney was very, very important to me. When Walt died, I decided I couldn't work there any longer. And that's what really kick-started my my move back to academia. I decided to go back to graduate school and continue on in the career that I'm in now. In my graduate degree program, I have a PhD in behavioral sciences from the University of Southern California, and as part of that program, I had to spend 5 years in really, really deep psychoanalytic kind of treatment. It was part of, everybody that went through our program had to do this. And I ran into a guy who was my, he became my mentor, but also at first was my therapist. And he was amazing. And he started the process of me very gently uncovering all that had happened, both with my parents, as they in fact contributed to all that had taken place, and then the actual abuse, and then my long-term inability to cope with that. So it was there that I started to see that it really wasn't, you know, intellectually I could get it, but I started to really feel that it really wasn't my fault. A 9-year-old kid could not and should not have to be the one that incubates himself or keeps himself from attack of a predator. And he also helped me understand the deep, deep hatred, if you will, that I carried away from this with my mom. And I got to a place that I could actually talk to her again later on. But here's the important point. At the time of the rape, just after it took place, my mom said to all of us as a family, "We are never, ever talking about this again. We're going to assume this didn't happen." And we picked up the next day and moved to California so that there would be no remnants of my history. What I carried with me as I started to integrate from the Midwest, where all of this had taken place, to moving to California, was I'd hoped that my family dynamic, that things would change. I bought into, okay, we're not going to talk about this again. Never happened. I'm going to try to push it away, and things will be great. My mom and dad will get their family stuff together. My dad was an alcoholic. My mom was this kind of really, really brutal person. But I thought maybe that would change. It didn't. It went on until I just couldn't stand it anymore. And being an athlete, I had a way out of the house. I left when I was 15 just because I could. And I was done with it. Not with what had happened, but I was done with my family. Because that's the only way I felt I could survive. Parents are life saviors for kids that are raped or abused. They either create psychological wounding or they create healing based upon how they handle it. If they can open their arms to kids, even after they've been molested and sexually abused, and again, particularly boys, and to let them know it wasn't their fault and that they love them no matter what, and then together we could all get through this. But if a parent takes an approach that what I see in front of me now is tarnished, it's dirty, it's my kid is somehow without rehabilitation, my kid is something to be embarrassed of, and either start to deal with them in a punitive way, you know, beat them, hit them, yell at them, curse them, or just walk away from them. It makes the wounding so deep that recovery is almost impossible. So I wish my parents had been that parent that would have, instead of heading out of town, they would have stayed there and found out what had happened, who did it, held me, loved me, cared for me, and then maybe things would have been a little different. It's really important that parents become present. I can't tell you from all that I've seen over all of these years, just the difference of a parent caring and watching and being there for their children. Pedophiles are really, really smart in most cases. They're viciously intuitive. And so what they do is they look at a group of kids and they figure out who's the kid that's most socially isolated, or the kid that doesn't have as many friends, or the kid that is the poorest of the group. And then we'll begin a process of getting to know that kid. We call it in my world in social science, grooming. And it's a gradual process of bringing that child from victim to sexual participant. So what parents have to do is they have to be aware of what their kid's doing. You know, who are they playing with? Who do they hang out with? Are they spending time with a teenage kid that looks kind of weird and crazy? I mean, I say that very pejoratively, but yes. And so you have to pay attention to what your kids are doing. That doesn't mean you should be a kind of a tyrannical monster and try to boss them around, but you can't turn your back on them. I mean, it is a lifetime commitment. It changes your life. And if you just think it's having a kid is a kind of a nice thing to do, it puts me in a certain club or something, boy, take a good look in the mirror and see if this is what you really want to do. The boy that raped me, he was 15. And what happened through that process was that it forever changed my life. It was something that I lived with until today, still do today. After it happened, I became isolated from my peers. I had no friends. I was always looking at somebody, you know, what might they do to me, even as I got older. And so what I ended up doing is that somehow I had this second kind of endowment. I was really fairly socially adept. I was able to influence people. But on the inside, I was just doing it to protect myself. I didn't want to get close to anybody. So, relationships. I had lots and lots of relationships with women. And, they were superficial at best. And I was in a team sport, and I played in a position that ensured I was a wide receiver. I was the farthest guy in the program. I didn't have to really talk to anybody. I just did my thing. I've kind of lived a half a life, never a full life. I don't want people to feel sorry for me, but the reality was that I really just tried to compensate. I just tried to get by, and did so through my life. And the way it showed up the most was I had this tremendous sense of guilt that this was my fault. I caused this. And I should have been able to have done something about it. I should have been able to, ward off the predator that was after me. Did I do anything to encourage him? That was the biggest thing. So it has had a huge impact, but I never ever really got interested in studying or doing research on child abuse. And as I look back on that, I really think that it was because I just could not stand excavating all that I had felt. And so I walked away from that area and I found myself into very, very kind of success-oriented people that I was studying to understand how they operated. I tried to stay as far away from my past as I could. Today, it's probably one of my big regrets. Yeah, I could have done a lot in the field because I had experience. You know, this took place to me. I can tell you what happened here. I can show you how it works. But when I started to professionally look at what I was going to do with the rest of my life, I nibbled around the edges of dealing with kids that were kind of in aberrant communities, but I could not put myself in a place that I actually got involved with either those that were abusers. I could not stand that. I couldn't think about in any way being helpful to somebody like Davey. I felt so vulnerable. If I opened up this scab and I really had nobody around me, nobody that really understood me, even my own family at the time had no idea of this. I didn't have any supports. I had not sought them. I mean, I had not tried to make this happen. And I just felt like that if I did this, it might just destroy me. I'm not sure I could have taken the pain of that. So I walked away, kept it inside of myself. And it wasn't until a couple of years ago that I decided I had to do something. I couldn't just let it set there. I couldn't finish my life with this unmet burden. The overwhelming sense of guilt never has gone away. I feel at times that I'm worthless. I feel like, am I really authentic, or am I just kind of pulling the wool over people's eyes? So there's I hate the idea of people feeling sorry for me. I do not want that. But to say that I am whole, that I am, you know, without scars these days would not be true. And I'll die with what I think is, I'll die as half a person. I ask sometimes, what would have happened if I had not had this experience? Well, you know, we always talk about the good superficial things that happen to you because of terrible events. There is some of that. But I wonder if I had been able to play my life at full tilt, at the best rhythm that I could play in, would it have been different? Just speculation. I think so, but I don't know. What would I like to say to my 9-year-old me, the little Pete that was me? I would like to say to him that his tenacity, his bravery, his kind of willingness to face his demons kind of head on and still move forward was something that he should be very, very proud of. And I'd also like to say to him is that the mistakes that he made after growing up, were certainly real mistakes. But they were contaminated with the baggage that he had had to experience. And so I would like to give him a chance to be both proud and at the same time to be understood and loved without condition. If I was talking to kids or with those that have been abused that are now adults, get help. Whatever you can, get help. Talk to somebody, whether it's in your church or whether it's finding a therapist, but don't suffer alone. And in most cases, you know, your friends and family can be sympathetic, but they're not going to have a full understanding of what's happened to you. And you need that third party that can help coach you through the travails that you've been feeling. And so that at least at the point you'll end up that you don't have to carry this burden by yourself. There are others that can help you. So that would be my message to them. And there are some really good group activities where you can actually spend time talking to others that have been molested or even raped. One of the great experiments is kind of social groups of parents that have had kids abused getting together and talking about it. It is magnificent to see the guilt that they're feeling go away or at least be mitigated to where they start to replace that with understanding and love of their kid again. So what I want them to take away is, one, the stories that I tell. But mixed into that is my perspective as a behavioral scientist. I haven't found anything that matches up to Lost Boy Found. I'm not sure I will. And I'm kind of looking at, this may be it. This may be the message that I leave the world with. I'm going to keep writing every day. Oh, I journal. I do it in the morning, and I write about my gratuitous sorts of events for that day, and then I think about what I hope to accomplish the day going forward, and I really try to make it all very positive. And it's amazing. It is such a huge thing that we can do for ourselves. And the science really backs that up.